want the next session of the day and the last session of the day, we want the guest lecture session. For this, we have three speakers. I first invite Dr. Rama Reddy, sir, who will be speaking on Alzheimer's disease in diabetes patients. And to chair this session, I welcome Dr. Rajesh, sir, and Dr. Ashutosh Prasad, sir.
Good afternoon, sir. And it's a privilege to introduce Dr. Rama Reddy, sir. Dr. Rama Reddy, sir, is Dr. B.C. Roy National Awardee, and he has Dr. D.L.N. Murthy Rao Oration Award, and he has IMA National Diamond Jubilee Oration Awardee, Dr. Amit Bora Oration Awardee, IMA National Dr. Menda Oration Awardee, and GAPIO Lifetime Achievement Award, Dr. Vaidyalingam Oration Award, and Vishaka Oration Award, and Civic Reception by Rajahmundry Municipal Corporation, and more than 50 awards or titles, and he has National Limca Book and World Records and Guinness World Book and Wonder Golden Star, etc., for most varied education qualifications of more than 31 degrees, diplomas and certificates. Is the past president of Indian Psychiatric Society and South and Zonal Branch. Has treated more than 136,000 psychiatric patients. I welcome you, sir, for the session.
Shall I share my screen, sir? Am I audible, sir?
You're audible, sir.
My screen is visible?
Yes, sir. Your screen is visible, sir.
Okay. Thank you, madam. Good evening, everybody. Today, I'm expected to speak something on Alzheimer's disease and type 3 diabetes. I know it is a controversial issue, but I have taken purposefully so that it sensitizes our professionals. I welcome you all for this session of EuroCon 2020, second day neurology session. And I pay my respects to organizing chairman Ravi Garu and secretary Venkat Raj Garu, and also the president Sashkir Rao Garu, vice president Varu Prasad Garu, secretary Vijay Sekhar Garu. And also I thought the chairpersons would be Srinivas Reddy Garu, Pushparaj Garu and Rajesh Garu. Anyhow, Rajesh Garu is there. And my respects to Ashutosh Prasad Garu and Madam, who is conducting all the things. First of all, let me start with a disclaimer. I am not a neurophysician. I am neither a neurophysiologist or no neuropathologist. I am not an endocrinologist or a diabetologist. I am not an expert in nutrition science. I am not a fan of any socially active non-medical diet advisors. I am a psychiatrist. 66-year-old perpetual learner. That's my qualification. So I entered into this controversial thing. As you know, we have got billions of neurons, trillions of synapses, and among those synapses, quadrillions of permutations and combinations of connectors. So much wealth of brain we have got. But in spite of that, unfortunately, great intellectual person, a renowned professor, at the age of some 60 or 70, losing his brain. What is the reason? Alzheimer's disease. I think most dreaded disease which anybody would fear is Alzheimer's disease. I would prefer to get a heart attack rather than getting an Alzheimer's disease. Usually, this is the situation. When we think about the deficits, neurotransmitter deficits, degenerated neurons, synaptic dysfunction, extracellular buildup of amyloid beta, intracellular neurofibrillary tangles, so those things, the pathology, we could understand. And when we go into the details also, so many toxic things, brain atrophy, neuronal toxicity, aggregation of the plaques, tangle formation, aberrant brain activity, and cholesterol or lipid metabolism down, neurogenesis down, glucose metabolism down, synaptic functions down, and the clearance of the plaques is gone down. Vascular function is down, mitochondrial function is down. So much we could understand what is happening. And when we try to find out the reasons for this one, okay, we could find a gene, heredity, yes. If one gene is transmitted, yes, some extent. When from two parents, when both the parents, it is the risk is more. And it is more among the patients, not with the controls. So hereditary factors, we could understand. And also postmortem studies, we could find the beta amyloid plaques. And also neurofibrillatory tangles. But when the problem is elephantine, when we are blind, we try to describe the things in different perspectives. A psychologist describes in one perspective, and biochemistry man describes in another perspective, and pathology man, and nutrition man also describes in some other perspective. And it is one of the perspectives, Alzheimer's disease as a metabolic condition. We know that diabetes or insulin resistance, type 2 diabetes especially, it is known to produce some changes in the brain. Alzheimer's disease, as you know, it produces them. And sometimes when these two things together, can we synthesize something? That synthesis is type 3 diabetes. Diabetes, whether it is DM1 or DM2, has influence on memory processing. We know it produces brain atrophy and synaptic communication disruptions. And on one hand, when we study about the diabetes, we think about the genetics, physical exercise, insulin, age, food, all these things. Even we try to prevent the diabetes also in pre-diabetics, prone people. And from Alzheimer's disease, we think about the so many symptoms and all. And we try to, we have produced so many drugs to improve cholinergic function or so, and so on. So many things are happening from this side, and from the other side also, things are happening. Earlier, it was found that those people who are having diabetes, whether it is T2 or T1, especially T2, they have independently, although Alzheimer's disease and diabetes are independent metabolic disorders, even if we think, but there are certain common pathophysiological changes occurring in the signaling pathways, and also insulin resistance responsible for inflammatory pathways. So let us try to link these two things. Insulin resistance could be there here, could be there. And signaling, IGF signaling is defective here and there. Inflammatory response, oxidative stress, and also signaling mechanisms of other systems, amyloid beta plaques, neurofibrillary tangles, acetylcholinesterase activity regulation. So all these things can be found here, can be found there also. So here the hypothesis is, without even type 2 diabetes, if similar changes occur in the brain and it leads to Alzheimer's like disease, can we call it as type 3 diabetes? Because diabetic symptoms are not there. Hyperglycemia is not there, and he is not found to be diabetic at all. But still he has got insulin resistance, and all the other symptoms are there, and the brain is deteriorating. Brain function is deteriorating. This insulin resistance, neurotoxin, neurodegeneration, especially hippocampus, insulin signaling, and leading to the disruption of the memory and executive functions. Increased prevalence of insulin abnormalities and insulin resistance is the crux of the problem, because of which we are calling it as type 3 diabetes. Brain, you know, it is an organ of bulimia. It is although it is of 2% size, it consumes a lot, 10 times more than what its weight is. Brain's typical requirement of glucose per day is 110 to 145 grams per day. When it is reduced in the form of, metabolic rate of glucose, when it is reduced from the baseline, then 50 to 80 showed aged, between aged 50 to 80 showed, when the reduction is there, there are cognitive dysfunctions almost leading to Alzheimer's disease. Larger the reduction in the metabolic rate, but quantitative also, not only qualitatively, quantitative also, more reduction in the metabolic rate of glucose, higher the risk for cognitive decline. So it indicates that there is something going on fishy, whether in the periphery diabetes is found or not, because of the starvation. The brain is, when the brain is relatively starving, when the brain's energy supply is somewhat disrupted, memory and cognition gets impaired. So this is the hypothesis. Glucose hypometabolism, although we are linking with Alzheimer's disease, many symptoms can occur, like tremors, sleep disturbances, sometimes Parkinson's symptoms, anxiety, anger, depression, concentration, lack of concentration. So many symptoms can occur with the hypometabolism of glucose. Just simply hypoglycemia, man, he can get so many symptoms, is not including delirium, and he can go into the stupor and so on. So similarly, hypometabolism, when it is going on for months together, it leads to many things. Our concept is brain energy deficit precedes cognitive decline in conditions of increased risk for Alzheimer's disease. It is practically observed by clinicians like me. We clearly find it is a case of dementia, probably Alzheimer's. But when we go for MRI or so, normal. But after 6 months or 1 year, it shows brain atrophy. That means even before we could detect the brain atrophy in the scan, we could clinically detect this one. Here, even 5 years before also, even 7 years before also, before the cognitive decline occurs, we could find the energy deficit with PET scans and all, so that he is the man who is going to have this cognitive deficit, minimal cognitive deficits, and later he may land in Alzheimer's. We can predict even many years before if we could really care for that one. This is the concept. Regional brain glucose hypometabolism in young women with polycystic ovary syndrome, when PET scans are done, they showed deficits in working memory, and they showed abnormalities in the form of hypometabolism of the glucose. For a polycystic ovary syndrome woman, we don't suspect anything at the stage, to even 24-year-old woman also. Then we can predict that this woman is going to land this one. One controversial issue is, here in insulin resistance, the insulin hyperinsulinemia is occurring. Is this insulin is crossing the brain-blood barrier and entering into the brain, and it is destroying the brain cells? It is a controversial issue. Insulin circulating in the blood can cross BBB through a receptor-mediated active transport system, they say. Then naturally hyperinsulin should be there in the brain tissues also. But converse is also seen by some of the studies. This I am going to explain in a few minutes. Insulin regulates the expression and levels of GABA, NMDA, AMPA mediated mechanisms, which have strong influence over long-term potential. See, all the memories we cannot store, is it not? See, in the RAM, we keep the memories, and after some time, we keep in the hard disk. And from the RAM, so many things will go away. Even in the hard disk also, maybe disuse atrophy may occur for the memories. See, this long-term potentiation, long-term depression, these things are controlled by insulin. Fully differentiated neurons are permanently post-mitotic cells, which lack regeneration. We know that neuron cell cannot be regenerated once it is dead, but still, the others can take over the function. That's what we call as neuroplasticity, in the form of forming the new connections and all. This, because of the lack of ATP, because of the energy crisis, oxidative stress, they either die or experience apoptosis. Degeneration can cause neuronal degeneration and loss. Brain neurons or tissues are highly demanding excitable cells, in which more than 40% of the present ATP is based to keep neurons viable. Just to live, just to make the viability, 40% of the ATP is required. And not only the neuronal cells, but also the astrocytes, glial glucose transport system also should be okay to supply the energy. Otherwise, it may get disrupted. Free radicals, oxidative stress, dysfunction of mitochondria, energy defects, and neuronal degeneration. So these are the things which can occur because of the metabolic error in the. Then how can we nourish the starving neurons? It is a nutritional approach towards Alzheimer's. They are having hypometabolism of glucose. Glucose supply is so badly affected because of the insulin resistance also. So how to go across this problem? Preservation of cell architecture is necessary. Although we think that when the brain tissue is atrophy, that means we find some atrophy in the cells, all the cells need not die. They may go into hibernation like. They would be shrunken, neurons may get shrunken. So to maintain the cell architecture, they require some energy. Cell membrane physiology, whether it is okay or not. And also dysfunction of the mitochondria, which are the batteries or powerhouses of the cells, which has to be maintained well. So here in type 3 diabetes are the diabetes-like syndrome which is affecting the brain without having diabetes type 2 symptoms in the body like hyperglycemia. Predominant abnormality is 40% reduction in cerebral glucose utilization. Brain hypometabolism is responsible for this one. Progressive region-specific declines, especially those which are vulnerable, like hypothalamus or hippocampus or the areas where which are sensitive, cerebral glucose metabolic rate is down. Insulin is supposed to be the villain. One of the titles of a book is Insulin the Stupid. That means insulin, of course, insulin is, pain, for example, or fever, those are all protective in nature. But at the same time, we blame them. Similarly, insulin, which has got a lot of role in the body functions, it is responsible, it is the villain for abdominal obesity, PCOS, low HDL and high triglycerides, hypertension, gout, skin tags, erectile dysfunction, BPH, and so on. Here, hyperinsulinemia, even before the onset of mild cognitive impairment, cerebral metabolic rate of glucose is down because of hyperinsulinemia. Because of the time pressure, I'll go through fast. See here, because of brain insulin resistance, the cell membranes do not allow the insulin to act on them. So when the insulin sensitivity is lost, naturally glucose cannot enter into the body. So body in the sense of body of the cell. And at the same time, it produces so much insulin is accumulating there. When insulin is accumulating there, immediately it has to be mopped out. To mopping out, certain enzymes are there. So those enzymes are taking the function of mopping out the insulin. Then this beta amyloid, because it is not taken care of, it accumulates. Normal blood sugar level, normal A1C, normal everything, OGTT, glucose tolerance test, it is also normal. But still, when insulin is tested, hyperinsulinemia occurs. Unfortunately, it so happens that insulin is tested sometimes fasting insulin. And invariably, it comes normal. See, when we go for vitamin D levels, invariably it goes low. B12 estimation, invariably they give low results. Similarly, for insulin somehow, although there are symptoms of hyperinsulinemia, fasting, for that also they have given explanation. Fasting is not sufficient. Go for 5 hours after food, insulin. So that gives the best result, people say. When hyperglycemia is happening, naturally insulin gets secreted. And because insulin is going up and up, this insulin is telling, come on, take the glucose, absorb the glucose. So it tries to push the thing. But ultimately, this blah, 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 blah from the insulin will not be listened by the cells. The cells become deaf and, okay, whatever you shout, I'm not going to open. The locks and the key will not be compatible. So more the glucose we put into the body in the form of diet or so, more insulin will be secreted. In spite of the more insulin, unfortunately, cells are not in a position to absorb. So here, the similar pathology occurs in the brain also. But here, surprising thing is, insulin, whether it is high in the brain or low in the brain, insulin initially goes high, but as soon as it enters there, it gets mopped up. So finding the low levels of insulin people tried to give nasal sprays of insulin so that insulin improves. Even diabetologists also sometimes do the same thing. DM2, type 2 diabetes, although it is known that insulin resistance case, they, if the oral diabetic drugs fail, they try to give insulin. Although it looks, why giving insulin when insulin is more? No, insulin works so well. Similarly, insulin is given and they found some initial improvement, but that is not the thing. It is like for a delirium tremens man, if you give alcohol, he becomes all right. But it is not the permanent thing, is it not? Similarly, here also. And this insulin resistance, insulin's function is to send glucose into adipose tissues, skeletal muscles, liver, glycogenesis, so on, so on. All these things you know. See, this resistance to insulin, it's one thing. The second thing, because of the hyperinsulinemia, ultimately the pancreas gets fatigued and it stops secreting proper insulin. So two defects, burnout, something like burnout. Because of the time pressure, I think I'll go fast. So these are the alterations in the brain metabolism, decrease in the glucose metabolism, insulin resistance, alteration in the amyloid precursor proteins, amyloid beta toxicity on one hand. Here, defect in the signal transduction, tau hyperphosphorylation, microtubules breakdown, mitochondrial dysfunction, oxidative stress, here cytokines activation, inflammations, so ultimately leading to neuronal death. This amyloid beta peptides, see, different types are there, and also gene-wise also different mutations are there, especially hippocampus, hypothalamus, cerebral cortex and olfactory bulb. These are the things which get affected. And various mechanisms also have been delineated, how the neuronal damage occurs, various angles. Microglia and insulin signaling, synapse failure, failure in various areas leading ultimately to the death of the cell. And these things also escape, inflammation, apoptosis. Long-term potentiation, in a normal man, long-term potentiation and long-term depression is down and long-term potentiation more in a healthy adult. Whereas in type 3 diabetes, it gets reversed because of these problems. This also, various mechanisms, this also escape. Glucose transporters, hyperglycemia, leading to this one. This gene, what is it happening? See, we have found some genetic material which is responsible for the genesis of for the development of Alzheimer's disease. But for the expression of this one, the other factors like metabolic factors also should be responsible. It is something like seed and soil. See, the children who inherit the diabetes gene from the parents, all of them may not become diabetics. Some may get the disease, some may not get the disease. It is because of the seed and soil thing. Similarly, one gene, two genes, deleterious effect because of the genetic overload, and also the high carbohydrate diet, which is responsible for this precipitation of the thing. APOE4 accounted for approximately 24% of the general population and more than 50% among Alzheimer's diseases, responsible for interrupting how the brain processes. Here, again, whether this gene is responsible for this metabolic error or metabolic error is responsible for genetic expression is also a controversial thing. The clumps, because of this gene, the protein becomes sticky. And because of the stickiness of the protein to the cell membranes, naturally the absorption sensitization of the insulin the sensitizers will not occur because of this thing. The clumps get trapped there because of the sticky protein, they say. Insulin signal processing would get impaired because of the protein. Then amyloid plaques. All these days people are thinking that these plaques are destroying this thing. Then why these amyloid plaques are these pathological? Even normal people also would be having that one, but immediately gets mopped off. Whether those are cause or effect. See, fire is there, either fire due to short circuit or short circuit is due to fire. Both the things can happen. Similarly, these blocks also, there is enzyme called insulin degrading enzyme. It is something like a mother is having two children or three children, and mother has to take care of both the children. And somehow mother would be having, maybe having a favorite child, and may not, although children are equal, one favorite child. See, here insulin degrading enzyme has the favorite child is insulin. And whenever insulin is coming more into the brain, insulin degrading enzyme would be acting on that one. So that neglecting our amyloid beta protein. So amyloid beta protein gets accumulated. It failed to stimulate the clearance of amyloid beta protein because of the insulin effect. Susceptible to neurotoxic insults. The plaques, hippocampal atrophy, lower cerebrocortical glucose metabolism with insulin resistance. Decreased neuronal inflammatory cascade. The cause and effect, toxicity cause. See, because of that, this amyloid beta protein, this toxicity can produce insulin resistance, some people think. That means, again, cause and effect, the plaques are responsible for insulin resistance, some people say even. So these are the things which have to be naturally unraveled in the future studies. Glutamate induced excitotoxicity leading to neurodegeneration. And calcium overload, NMDA and AMPA receptors. What happens is because of this insulin resistance, there is the membrane mechanism, cell membrane mechanisms get disrupted, leading to influx of lot of sodium, a lot of calcium, and leads to bulging of the cells, and the potassium would go out. And this influx of the calcium is responsible for the destruction of the mitochondria, leading to neurofibrillary tangles, they say. And cholinergic neurotransmission, we understand more about that one, and we have produced many drugs also to improve that one. And hormonal changes also can occur. These changes, hyperglycemia, glutamatic control, then insulin resistance. See, when this hypothesis or when this concept is talked about, then Alzheimer's disease, I think we can detect some 5 years or 10 years before, is it? By finding insulin resistance in the body. Yes, it looks so so beautiful. Fasting insulin and also the HOMA-IR test. That is homeostatic model assessment of insulin resistance. That is a simple formula. Fasting blood sugar into fasting blood insulin divided by constant 404. And certain levels are fixed. If such certain level is there, it is mild insulin resistant. If certain level is more, it is a moderate, and so on. And insulin level 5 hours after OGTD, this is a very important card says. And this is another controversial thing. Statin drugs. These days, so many publications are coming out that statins are no good at all. But people, our physicians say that statins we have been using for decades together, they reduce the dyslipidemias, so they correct that one. How can we blame statins? But they say that because of statins, some cognitive deficit. Indeed, the brain needs cholesterol. We should not interfere with the cholesterol. It is not the high fat which is responsible for the havoc. It is the high carbohydrates, which are responsible for the whole thing. Higher cholesterol is, to some extent, it is protective only, people say, for healthy aging, this one. Okay, what do we do about it? This consequence is the conflict between the ways old. 100 years back, people were eating in one way, and nowadays we are eating in a modern way. So nowadays, diabetes more, Alzheimer's also more. If we revert back to the earlier stages, then I think we can prevent Alzheimer's, and we can have Alzheimer's antidote-like. We can reverse it even. Amy Berger, a nutritionist, she has written a book, Alzheimer's Antidote, and which is one of the best sellers. And she is a protagonist for this type of concepts. What it is said is human brain, it is a hybrid car like. Hybrid car means it runs not only on the petrol, but also with electricity also. And we can do work with horses in a traditional way, or we can work with modern way with a tractor, something like that. So here, the brain works usually with glucose because plenty of glucose is there. But when the glucose is low, if we feed with ketones it can function so well. Indeed, ketone is preferred one because ketone gives more energy. Glucose has to be pulled into the brain. But whereas ketones, when ketones are more in the bloodstream, they naturally go into the brain. So only thing what we have to do is put a lot of ketones into the bloodstream, then those will be taken care of and the brain gets normal. Ketone is supposed to be high octane brain fuel. See here, this shows that young healthy control, 95% glucose and 5% ketone, no energy gap at all, healthy. But old man, but without much more memory problems. Glucose intake is only 89%, ketone also less, 3%. So there is gap of 8% minus. Here mild memory problems, minus 12%. And mild memory problems, but 30 grams of medium chain lipids or fats are given. Then 3% improved to 7%. Mild memory problems, when 45 grams are given, then 10% improvement. So that means only minus 6% only. So by giving the ketones in the form of MCTs, there will be an improvement. Two points are clear. Alzheimer's disease is at least in part exacerbated by chronic progressive brain fuel starvation. Attempting to treat the cognitive deficit early in the stage with ketogenic interventions is safe, ethical and scientifically well-founded. It is said not by nutritionists. These are said by our neurologists and physicians. People, when they hear about ketosis, oh, ketosis means pathological. No. Pathological ketoacidosis due to diabetes and all, due to fasting and all, that is a different issue which would be high. Whereas benign nutritional ketosis is it is something like a shower, raining shower. Whereas the pathological ketoacidosis is something like a tsunami. And we should not think, compare both the things. When people say talk about ketosis, by taking the ketogenic diet, kidneys get damaged, this thing damaged, and I know about a person who died. So even with our drugs also, with our anti-epileptics, with our antidepressants, with our antipsychotics, some people die, and those people who are skeptics about the modern medicine, they keep on criticizing. Psychiatry is nothing but brain-destroying discipline, people say. So things of that thing happen. But is ketogenic diet really so unhealthy? As long as it is prescribed by a doctor, a medical doctor who knows about the person, one need not criticize about this one. Ketogenic diet may even diminish and clear beta amyloid plaques. So these are all not just saying things. These are all in PubMed from 2000 onwards till today. So many articles are there. Impaired lipid transportation, mainly this one. How to raise the ketones? Low carbohydrate. I am not saying that here are two things. One is ketogenic diet means taking only less than 10 or 15 grams of carbohydrates. So that is the thing. But moderate thing is low carbohydrate and high fat diet. That is taking up to some 30 or 40 grams of carbohydrate, which we all can do. Fasting is intermittent fasting. So many people are getting benefited with the intermittent fasting. Exercise, nobody can deny the improvement of this one. For this medium-chained lipids, coconut oil, sesame oil, those are found to be very good. But one thing, even the palm oil also, although when we hear about the palm oil, that cheap palm oil with all dirty fatty acids and all, we may think. But even that one also, see, this one, cold-pressed virgin oils, they say. So those things would be beneficial. the ability of ketones to supercharge the body has been designated as super fuel, medium chain triglycerides, simplest and cost effective, prevention via diet, and starting with this low carbohydrate and increasing the essential fatty acids like omega 3 fatty acids, a nutrition. So many things are described: antioxidants, carotenoids, polyphenols, flavonoids, omega 3 fatty acids, curcumin. Curcumin is known to produce pro-apoptotic signaling pathways in primary hippocampal neuron cultures. It hurts exercise. Metformin also, they have tried whether it improves the insulin resistance. There are some studies which say that metformin improves. There are some studies that metformin does not have any insulin. So ultimately, I conclude saying that I am not an authority on this subject, but at the same time, I have seen patients, after viewing this thing, I have seen patients improving. I have seen patients really improving and getting back their cognitive functions, not only in Alzheimer's, but in LB disease also. Lewy body disease patients also, although they are said to be somewhat having worse prognosis, and close people whom I could observe. I don't say that I have stopped the medicines. I have given this one as an adjunct, and it has given some results. And of course, I am not supposed to say about the anecdotal things. Only thing is, evidence-based we have to follow, and lot of evidence we could see in PubMed. Alzheimer's disease as a metabolic condition also we can think about, as an adjunct we can think about, and without diabetes of other body organs or hyperglycemia, which is the hallmark of diabetes, we can consider Alzheimer's disease as type 3 diabetes even, and in that view also, in that perspective also, we can see that one. I think I have crossed my time. Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity.
Thank you very much, sir, for a very lucid presentation of a controversial futuristic topic, and thanks for the diet advices, which are in general very useful as on today. It's anyway there on YouTube, sir, so there will be more later.
Okay.